There is a redeemer.
Good day, friends, and we are glad again to be with you, and we say praise the Lord. We have the panel discussion as per usual, and we'll be going in today into service. Newly saved, you going on for the Lord, and we want you to recognize that service is of importance. So we'll ask our brother David Roberts to open in a word of prayer for us.
Shall we pray? Our blessed God, and our gracious God, and Father Jesus Christ, we give thee thanks for whom thou art in thyself. We praise and we magnify thy name. We give thee thanks for thy goodness to us in bringing us together in this place. And we ask, O Lord, that thou will lead and guide us. We look to thee, Lord, for thy blessing on the hearts of all those who will view this discussion. And O Lord, that it will help even those who are born again, those who are saved by thy wonderful grace, to grow in grace and in knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, to labor for thee, knowing thee, O Lord Jesus Christ, it says, work when it is day, for the night cometh when no man can work. So we give thee thanks, Lord, that in this world we can labor for thee, we can do something for thee. Thou hast left us in this world, that we serve thee, and Lord, that we serve thee in spirit and in truth. So we give thee thanks, we give thee praise, and so lead us to Jesus Christ, O Lord. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Yes, dear friends, and those who are looking on, we want to say, we are glad to be with you again. And as was mentioned, we are going into service. It's very important. Save to serve. You're saved now. You're a child of God. And you need to do service for the Lord. And those who are not yet saved, you can accept the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior. And you too can do service for the Lord. So we are looking at service. And I want to open in a very familiar verse. It's Ephesians 2, 8, 9, and 10. Tells us there, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any one of us or any man should boast. It goes on, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God had before ordained that we should walk therein. Good works, which before God had ordained that we should walk therein. So as was mentioned, we are looking at works. And what can we say about works? I'll turn over to Brother Jack to give us some.
It's an honor and a privilege again to come into your home with this broadcast, Moments with Truth. And we trust that our time will be for God's glory. Works. We did point out earlier that works, good works, don't save us. We are not saved by works. We are saved by grace through faith. Yes. Now that you have trusted Christ as Savior, God expects every one of us, young believer and old believer, to serve him acceptably with reverence and with godly fear. Yes. And so it is very important for us to serve God. As we said earlier, it's an honor to serve the living and true God. God could have done it differently. God could have done his service for himself. He could have commissioned the angels to do what we are doing. But God loves us with an eternal love. And having saved us by grace, he has instructed us, he has commanded us, he has commissioned us to go and preach the gospel and to serve him on this earth. So serving the Lord is an honor, it's a privilege, and to do so, we must do it wholly before God. Our lives must speak for God's eternal praise, honor, and glory before we open our mouths and speak to any about faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So we trust that as we look at this very important matter, this important subject of service to the Lord, every one of us will be encouraged and blessed. And for those who are not saved, that you will trust Christ as Savior and begin to serve the living and the true God.
And to emphasize what our brother just said, that we are not saved by works. Titus tells us, as Paul wrote to Titus, he said in Titus chapter 3 and verse 5, he said, "It is not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he has saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Spirit." We are not saved by works. If we were saved by works, then this will nullify the work that the Lord Jesus Christ did upon the cross of Calvary. He died, shedding his blood, that we could be justified even by his blood, that is precious blood that was shed for us. Only the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, can cleanse us from all sin. And sin is what separated us from God. And as we are cleansed from our sin, we are saved. We are saved and eternally saved. But God has left us in this world. And the Lord Jesus Christ, he worked. He did the works of his Father. He did many wonderful works even while he was on earth. And he said, "Let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify our Father who art in heaven."
Amen, amen. It is true, dear friends. Again, people figure that they have to work for salvation. We don't work for salvation, we work out our salvation. In other words, when you're saved now, you begin to work. And that work you're doing is a holy living. As one author will put it, it's a holy living. Your whole lifestyle is going to be now the work that God wants you to walk therein. You see, God has given us certain gifts. And these gifts, part of it, you see that is a part of work, wherein that you have to work. And we're going to be going into that in a while. But it is indeed a joy to work for the Lord. Amen? Yeah. Amen. It's a joy to work for the Lord because we know what is done for God is going to last. And we think that what we do for ourselves will last, but this transient things will just end off. And there we have the eternal things, wherein that our work will be well done. We will hear those wonderful words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." So our brother Jack is going to tell us more.
It's a joy and a privilege, as we said earlier, to serve the Lord. Now we must remember, as we are looking at our young believers, but we are speaking to everyone who is saved by the grace of God and everyone who is viewing this broadcast Moments with Truth. Now we might think, sometimes we think that serving the Lord means that I have to be a preacher, I have to be a missionary, I have to be an evangelist. Now these are people who are serving the Lord, yes, but every one of us is given the ability and the capacity to serve the living and the true God. Now we can serve and we ought to serve God even in our homes. We begin there, in our homes. And the word of God says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord." So young believers who are under the roofs of their parents, God expects you to obey your parents. And being obedient to your parents is serving the living and the true God. So we start there, and we want everyone to know, especially the young ones, you can serve God and you ought to serve God right in your homes with your parents, with your other brothers and sisters.
Amen, amen.
And you know, very often people don't realize that in everything that you do, you are serving the Lord. Mm. Whatever you do, you are serving the Lord. And as Paul wrote to the saints at the Colossae, he said this in chapter 3. And verse 17, he said, "And whatsoever ye do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord, giving thanks to God and to the Father by him." And furthermore, he said in verse 23, "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as unto the Lord and not unto men." So sometimes you are in your workplace, even in your homes, you're doing your chores. Sometimes you meet people on the wayside, need help. Whatever you do, do it heartily as
unto the Lord. So don't think only when you do work, probably in church or whatever, is unto the Lord. Whatever you do, wherever, it is unto the Lord.
Amen, amen, amen. The word work is nothing new, and it goes way back down into the beginning of time. The origin of it, when Adam sinned against God, God said, you will now go out and till the soil. That's work in itself. So we want you to recognize the work in the physical aspect and the spiritual aspect. Yes, you know you have your daily jobs, you have to do your daily work and daily routine. But we are dealing with much more than that. It's a lifestyle. It's the individual in Christ now is going to live out Christ. And you're going to see a lot of things when Christ had called us to do. It's work in itself. It's work in itself. So you can still do your daily work and live the work and do the work that God has called you to do. And this is what we want you to do. He wants you to live a life that is pleasing to Him. And when you do the works that God has set within your heart, He will be pleased. He will be pleased. So we must work while it is yet day, for the night cometh when no man can work. The Lord Jesus said that.
And then another thing. When we do our work, let us not look for a reward from man. Mm-hmm. But the one who judgeth righteously, mm-hmm. our Father who sees everything, He knows the motive in mm-hmm. which we do things.
That's right.
You know, we're not doing things as men please us for eye service. Mm-hmm. For the glory of men. The Pharisees did this. Mm-hmm. And the Lord Jesus called them hypocrites. Because mm-hmm. they did things that men should praise them, that people should mm-hmm. look up to them. So you're not doing things that, as a young believer, as a believer in the Lord, for the glory of men. And you know how strange it is, even in recent times, as we have exposed to the media, if someone is to probably hand out something, give a hamper, give something. You know, they call the media. You know, and this is exposed. Mm. This is publicized. And this is more or less what the Pharisees were doing, you know. Mm. They wanted people to praise them. They wanted people to see what they are doing. So if they are giving alms, they ring a bell to attract the attention of other people. And the Lord Jesus Christ said, well, what your right hand do, don't even let your left hand know. Mm-hmm. You know, you do things as unto the Lord, the one who sees, the one from whom we expect our reward.
Amen, amen, amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ, when we also think about service to the Lord, the greatest servant was the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Nobody served like Him. Remember, even when He was in the temple, of course the parents, they were all around in Jerusalem, and the time came when they had to take their exodus to depart. The Lord Jesus Christ remained, and He was being questioned, and He was questioning, answering questions, and asking questions. And of course, when the parents left, they discovered that He was not with them. They retraced their steps, and they found Him in the temple, and they spoke with Him. And He said very gently and very sweetly, "Wish ye not that I must be about my Father's business." He was serving the eternal God. He was serving His Father. So the greatest servant is the Lord Jesus Christ. And He was not disrespectful to His earthly parents. He was not disrespectful to Joseph. He was not disrespectful to Mary. And we are saying this to say that sometimes we think serving the Lord means that we disrespect our parents. That is not serving the Lord. God expects us. God commands us. God commands the young, especially all of us, that we ought to obey our parents. Be obedient. Honor your parents. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. And Jesus Christ is the perfect example for any form of service.
Amen, amen. And even to continue in the family life, you have the husband and wife as well. The husband ought to love their wives, and they love their wife. And this deals with obedience even unto the wife. you know, I give honor to your husband. And there's a work that goes on there. Love in itself, you will do things. And by doing those things, you know, the wife will appreciate it and there'll be a love, a bond. So work is like part of your lifestyle, as I mentioned before. And God is saying that here it is, you should continue in these areas. I told you before that in the Word of God, we are given certain gifts. And in giving God, giving you gifts, He realized that He wants you to function in certain areas. And you may think of the gift of evangelism, evangelizing. And that's a great area of service. And because the Word of God tells us in the book of Proverbs, he that winneth souls is wise. You see, that's it. You're bringing people into the kingdom of God. And evangelism is one that is greatly needed today. The harvest is in truth great, but the laborers are few. So God is calling us to spread the word, to speak a word of truth, to testify for him. And all of these are works that God will be glad to hear from you and to see you walk in. So evangelizing, what can we say about evangelizing?
Evangelizing is a wonderful, wonderful thing. It comes to mind also that the Lord Jesus Christ, when he entered into Gadara, and there was this man who was held by the legion, and he was destroying himself and so on. When the Lord Jesus Christ delivered that man, when the Lord Jesus Christ saved that man, he wanted to go with the Lord Jesus Christ. But the Lord said to him that he should go home to his friends and tell them. One of the Gospels says, show them. So he was to show and he was to tell what great things the Lord had done for him and how he has had compassion on him. The Word of God says in Mark's Gospel, chapter 5, that the man began to publish in Decapolis and in those areas what great things the Lord had done for him. So when one considers evangelism, God, the Lord Jesus Christ, sent the man to his home. And there is where we begin as God's holy people. We start in our homes to declare by lip, he said, to tell. And one of the Gospels says to show. So it is lip and life, or life and lip. Young believers, in your homes, serve the living and the true God. You may not be an evangelist, you may not be a public speaker, but if your lives speak for God in your family, I am sure, we are sure, that your parents, your other brothers and sisters will be touched with your testimony, and who knows, God can use it. And oftentimes he uses that life to save the others in your home.
Yes, because each and every one of us, everyone who has been saved by the wonderful grace of God, has a testimony. Mm-hmm. And must be able to testify what the Lord has done for them in transforming their lives, in that they are not no more in darkness, but now in light. No more dead in trespasses and in sins, but have everlasting life. And that must be an experience for everyone, and that experience must be shared. And to bring others to know him. Because the Lord Jesus Christ wants us to serve him in this area of telling others. That is why he commissioned his disciples. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. Perhaps we can't go into all the world, but we have our world in our home, in our schools, in our workplace, wherever we go, we can tell others of the Lord Jesus Christ's wonderful work that he has done in our lives. But even more than this, we can demonstrate this outwardly. Because while we tell others, we must show and demonstrate in our lives, indeed, that we can show good works. For example, someone may be in need. What do? Do we help or we turn our backs from them? And that is why I think James, a very practical man, you know, he said, you know, someone can make a profession, someone could speak of their faith, but their works do not demonstrate their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ, he demonstrated, as he did his many miracles, he demonstrated indeed that he had compassion on men. And we must have a heart of compassion to evangelize, because we must have a passion for lost souls.
Amen.
And we don't only evangelize by speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ, but showing indeed that he dwells in us. Our life should be a pattern of him. They should see him in us. How can the world see Jesus if they cannot see Jesus in us, in me? So I should somewhat demonstrate some of the characteristics of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the Christ in me. And even what I see will be a testimony indeed that the Lord Jesus Christ can save, he can transform, he can regenerate, and that he lives in me, he moves in me, he leads me, he guides me.
Amen, amen. I want to encourage another aspect of work, and this is in the area where the person is brought into fellowship. They are part of the church, and if you have not yet been to a Bible-believing, Bible-preaching church, you're not yet in fellowship, do so, because it will help you, as we mentioned before, the coals of fire. One coal by itself can go very dim, but with the others, it can give heat and it can share heat. So while you're in church, there are a lot of things there. While you're in the house of God, there are a lot of things there that we can work. If you go to your gifts again, the gifts of the Holy Spirit, you will see there certain gifts that God had mentioned. And these gifts, we are called to exercise these gifts. It's a work in itself. Administration. These are areas that you can be of benefit. So when the Word of God tells us work, there's a lot we can do for him. There's a lot. If we go into his word, you will see there that in the gifts, you have the gifts of giving, gifts of kindness, all these sort of things within, as our brother was mentioning, within the body of Christ, that is for the edifying of the saints and the building up of the saints, and the others will see and want to come to know the Lord Jesus as our personal Savior. So in the area of church service, let's hear about work in those areas of the church while you're in fellowship.
Before we go at the church, because it is pressing on my mind with respect to that little maid in Naaman's house. Now, she was taken from her home and placed there, and she could have been bitter. She was little, young, very tender, a little maid, the Bible calls her. But while she was there, Naaman was the captain, a great, great soldier. His wife, other soldiers, and other people. Strange place, strange people. So many things were strange to that little maid. But while she was there and looked at her master, Naaman was a pleasant man. She was moved, she was touched, and she wanted to see Naaman being cured of his leprosy. And there, very simply, very humbly, very graciously, she witnessed for God. Would God that my master were with the prophet. And arrangements were made for Naaman to be cured of his leprosy. We've said this to say, again, as young people with whom and to whom we are speaking, you can serve God, and you ought to serve God in your environment, even in your home. Now, the home life in our country, in the world, is under satanic attack. And if we serve God well, if we serve God acceptably in our homes, it will overflow in the villages, the community, in the island, in the country, and wherever the Lord places us on this earth. So again, we must point out that it's important to serve the Lord at and in our homes.
This was one of the things I was stressing or wanted to stress earlier, in that while we sometimes serve the Lord in church, someone will, you know, be in an area that they have a lot of responsibility and so on. If in your home you are different, you are not a testimony to perhaps your parents, your other siblings, etc., you are not showing to them, or you are not really testifying to them that indeed you are the Lord. You know, you are ineffective, as it were, to testify to them. They can say negative things, and it may turn them away from the Lord rather turning them to the Lord. Because that is why the Lord Jesus wants our lives to be a blessed example, an example of Him, that we should walk in the light even as He is light. That as we pattern our lives, looking at our Lord Jesus Christ, pattern our lives to His, people will certainly gravitate to us, because they will see Christ in us. They will see a difference in you. Sometimes you don't say one word, but just how you may move, how you may react to circumstances, how you may be kind, you know, gentle, etc. You show these graces, people will, are you a Christian? You know, they see it in you. And then you'll be able to testify of the Lord Jesus Christ even more effectively.
Amen. Our time is gone, and we again would like to reiterate and let you know that save to serve. You serve the Lord right where you are, and God is going to bless. Let's just pray. Father, we are again thankful for time spent in thy presence. We are thankful, O God, for the word of God shows us that we are his workmanship. Thus, we are given thus the opportunity of blessing him by doing what you have called us to do. And help us to recognize our gifts. Help us to recognize what we are called to do in the areas of service, that we can be a blessing, O God. We think of the home circle and we pray earnestly, Lord, let thy hand move within the homes. We know that some parents are not talking with their children. Some children are not talking with their parents. Lord, mend this, heal this in the name of Jesus. Bring peace in the home, for thus is very important. We are praying that husbands will continue to love their wives, and wives so as unto their husbands, that God will bless. So we are praying for the home circle, we are praying for the young ones, and most of all, those who have not yet come to the knowledge of thy saving grace, that they may come to know you, the only true and living God. Bless us as we do go, O God, giving thee thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till your work on earth is done.